Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the 33rd eBay Tech Talk already. We are here this evening to give you two talks. First, Christoph will give you a talk on test automation with RoboElectric and Espresso on Android. Enjoy.
So my name is Chris. I'm working for eBay, or actually eBay Kleinanzeigen. And I will kind of give you a short presentation about test automation on Android, a little bit more about the requirements and the beginning, how to start, how to get into it, but also some examples from actually our live system, which I believe will show you the possibilities the best, because usually you have super easy examples somewhere in the internet. Some blogs are giving you basic examples. You're like, okay, I understood it. You look into your own code and you're like, okay, that doesn't work with my code. And how to get into making it work for your code as well, we will present it a little bit more. Before I start with the real presentation, that's actually the eBay office we were talking about. And the eBay Kleinanzeigen office is actually this one, this on top. You have maybe seen it. It's kind of next to the interstate. And why I'm showing you this image is actually because not only we as kind of eBay Tech, but I'm looking for developers, iOS and Android developers, each one, just to scale up the team. We are growing, we need kind of more support, and we want to be more flexible there. This is our application, so we are kind of the mobile eBay Kleinanzeigen team, so the whole team is actually here. So all iOS, all Android developers, QA, and if you want to talk to us, just talk to us. And I think what's the biggest kind of thing to mention about our applications is the app ratings, because you can only reach those app ratings with actually two ideas. One is have a great product, because you can have the best software. If the product doesn't really kind of fit into the mindset of the people, you will never get those ratings. And the second one is the quality of your application. So you can have a great product, but if it crashes all the time or it has bugs, people will kind of give you bad ratings in the end. And then testing is usually kind of about also the complexity of your app. If your app just kind of do two things, you can maybe test that manually. But if you have like start a really complex application which has like different kind of technologies involved, and they are kind of sometimes also hidden, you don't want to test this by hand in the end, because it would be a painful process. But yeah, back to kind of the real topic, test automation. And before we kind of start with writing tests, you should kind of get yourself into the mindset of what does it mean to kind of try to automate as much as possible. And it all usually starts with a good CI server, because I think if you kind of don't have already this automation execution of your automated tests, you will end up in a situation where you, I don't run that test maybe today because I want to fix a small bug. Or we need to release, it's kind of just this one small fix before the release, we don't run the test suite, or like typical stuff, I'm the only guy, I don't need CI server or whatever. But I think automation starts already at this point, so first get the infrastructure done, and then kind of start writing your tests, and if it's kind of just 10 tests in the beginning, your CI server will execute them and you are already on the safe side. There's like a second person making sure it works. So it's not only working on your machine, it's also working on the second machine. So kind of get this first done. The second step is inversion of control, which is an important, I think, topic or concept to understand. There are two or multiple concepts. I think the most popular one is dependency injection. Heavily suggest to get into this, and I will also give you a small insight into this, but I could fill probably 2 hours with just talking about dependency injection. Or kind of there are also similar concepts, and I will also explain you a little bit the similar concepts. The main idea is to decouple your components and make sure you kind of are able to test them in a simulated area and each by itself and not as a huge block. But first, how about you? So I want to ask you, who is an Android developer here in the audience? Just to have a small overview. Oh, that's a lot. Okay, like half of the people. Who is iOS developer? Okay, also kind of 50%. Good, good. And other developer or kind of, or other non-developer? Okay. Yeah. But the majority seems to be mobile focused, but of course, you're welcome. We are also looking for non-only mobile developers, so eBay in general is hiring tons of people. Who is using a CI server already? Okay, a few, that's already good setup. Who is using dependency injection or a similar concept? Okay, it gets a little bit less, but still good amount of people. And who believes that he has a decent test automation or code coverage? I put just a random number. That number means nothing. Okay. But still good amount of people, so kind of good starting point. So first, just random two slides about continuous integration. So these are the three I already used. These are kind of Jenkins, Bamboo, and TeamCity. This one is completely free. This one have free options. It doesn't matter which you are using. I just suggest you to get into this topic and start using any of them. I still suggest using the first one personally, but you can use any of them. And this is kind of how our process works. So we work with Git. We push our stuff to GitHub, which is an enterprise license within eBay. Then Jenkins is kind of triggered. Jenkins knows, okay, there's new stuff. Someone changed code, and then all the stuff happens. Usually it depends on which branch you are, so sometimes more, sometimes less. But the important stuff is like running lint, unit tests, UI tests, and we also have Sonar checks that look into our code, make sure the code looks a little bit good, so it doesn't kind of find all bugs or so. But it usually helps to give you a little bit better structure about your code. And what happened recently is that we had an issue with networking, and Sonar was not working for like 3 weeks, and we kind of enabled it a few days ago. Nobody ran that locally, the CI server was not full set up, and we suddenly have like 60, 40 new issues, and now we need to kind of fix that. So that's why I heavily suggest you to have this infrastructure which always runs your test suites. Yeah, and it just saves time. Next is kind of the topic of inversion of control, and I found this illustration by Mike Bryant. I want to highlight him here. It's a very old article, and it gives you a little bit the insight of how kind of inversion of control works. So usually if you kind of start developing software without that concept, you build like software blocks and you use them, and it's actually absolutely fine. So I have stuff like this at home, and I don't have stuff like this at home. So it also works, so it's not kind of a shame. But you could imagine that, for example, to be your HTTP stack, and you kind of in production, you have this one, which really runs against your HTTP stack, live server, everything is fine. While in testing, you kind of replace one dependency, and this guy is actually loading everything from a file and does not do any HTTP stuff, and you can actually easily mock stuff and use data you already have prepared. From code perspective, it's actually really, you can explain dependency injection or inversion on control with just 5 lines of code. Stack Overflow, most upvoted example, I just picked this one. So you have this text editor, and it has a spell checker inside, and it's instantiated in the constructor. So whenever you see code like this, it's already kind of against the concept of inversion of control, so you kind of should avoid situations like this. You better write code like this, where you have an interface. You know what the checker is going to do, because it's obviously going to check your spelling. And you can kind of have different versions of it. You can mock that in testing, because you don't need to have it at all, or is actually that what you want to test. So it's really kind of, you just put whatever you need in this class via a constructor. And that's kind of very basic example. Everyone understands that. And then Android comes around and is like, okay, you have these activities, and you have these views, and you have these fragments. And they usually don't have, you don't write stuff like this. So you don't write new activity, and then you write, use the activity. You usually tell the system, hey, intent service, I want to have this activity started. And where to put my dependencies? Now, there's no constructor, right? For example, views, they have like 4 default constructors. And if you want to use them in XML layouts, you have to use this default constructor. And you can't just inject your dependencies easily via constructors. There are possibilities. One of them is Dagger 2, or you could also use Dagger 1. But I suggest using Dagger 2 now, if you never used any of the other ones. So the concept is actually quite easy. So you get this inject annotation before your dependency. You need to do some magic, which I'm not going to explain because, as I mentioned, this talk is not about dependency injection. But this will kind of make sure that those dependencies are resolved in the background. Dagger 2 is kind of a little bit huge learning curve in the beginning. It does lots of code generation in the background. You can look into that code. That's actually readable code. And yeah, but first of all, this talk is not about Dagger, so I'm sorry, I'm not going too deep into that. And we don't use Dagger 2, or actually also not Dagger 1. So we use a little bit of a different concept, which has nothing to do with dependency injection. It's actually called service locator, which is kind of a very similar concept. So it's also inversion of control, so the dependencies are kind of removed a little bit. So you basically just have a map, a hash map somewhere, and you put all your dependencies there. You just kind of inject them. So your key of the hash map is always the class or the kind of interface, and then there's the implementation. And if you need it, you just can use get, and you get whatever you need. It's not so that's kind of how you would inject. So you have the file system interface, an Android file system as an implementation, and now you could use get file system.class and use everything in this kind of Android file system. Here's how you kind of do that in an activity. So you have this my app, which is like your application instance. There's some reference to that hash map, and you get your dependencies from there. So they are just basically there. You don't need to use any constructors. And there's kind of no Dagger magic involved. You don't need to call anything in onCreate. It's just kind of happening in application onCreate. Now, service locator is not necessarily the best concept in the world. We agree with that. We had no issues with that, or barely any issue with that, in the past 5 years. So therefore, we just decided to continue using it because there was no Dagger 2 5 years ago. We did some researching and if we should switch, but we decided not to. But if you would kind of now have the decision how to start, go the Dagger 2 way. So here are just the reasons. So it's kind of the problem is that it's kind of all runtime. So there's the sesh map. If you try to access a dependency which is not in the sesh map, it will crash. Dagger doesn't allow you that because it's compile time check. Yeah, but finally, let's go into the unit testing, a little more interesting part. And we use RoboElectric for that. There are different kind of discussions currently going on because Android now has this kind of built-in unit testing, and people are kind of fighting which one is the better way, and we just decided to continue using RoboElectric. That's the basic example you get on the web page, which doesn't help you too much in the end. I mean, it gives you a little bit the insight of the possibility. So you kind of can create instances of activities, find views there, do clicks, and make sure that something on the UI kind of then has a different state, which already goes into a little bit more the direction of not being a unit test. It's kind of if UI is involved, and why is it a unit test? I also can suggest reading this article from actually 2010. So some Google engineers also had the issue, actually more about UI tests. So they kind of always had problems in communication about what is a unit test, what is a UI test. So different teams had different namings about this. I don't believe that their concept they kind of suggest in this kind of talk or blog post is the right one, but I still believe that kind of the problem is in most companies the same, that people kind of have a different understanding of what the test is, and you just need to find a solution for this because this is actually no problem. People just make a problem out of it. The main goal is actually to write tests and use some of those frameworks. It doesn't matter which you are using, just write those tests. It doesn't matter if the first 20, 100 tests are bad tests, just write them, because it's software development and you only learn software development by writing software, right? It's the same. It's not only in testing, it's also in writing production systems. And you need to have a definition for your team. So if you're talking with your team, they need to know what you are talking about. But it doesn't matter if someone from another company has a different understanding of what a unit test is, or in kind of the very deep details. So for us, everything which we write in RoboElectric, we just call it a unit test, just for understanding, because kind of we just right-click the runner on Android Studio and run the unit test, and the job in Jenkins is called unit tests. For us, everyone knows that's the unit test, right? Same for UI tests, so everything which we are writing with Espresso is a UI test. It doesn't matter if it's in the end an integration test, just tests the layout or an end-to-end test, whatever. That's a UI test, and we know kind of what we are talking about. But now a real-world example from our code. So I tried to pick a topic which somehow goes not too much into kind of our business logic, because usually people try to show tests with their business logic, and you don't understand the business logic, so you don't understand the test. But I think like tracking, so Google Analytics is something everyone kind of has some connection to. And it basically just you have this track screen, and you track screens in Google Analytics, so you kind of know how the screen performs, and you have some additional data there. And that's one interface we created. So I just want to highlight those two kind of methods. And then you have the real implementation for Google Analytics, which kind of uses then the SDK from Google Analytics, and this is kind of the code you need to really use when you want to use the Google Analytics SDK. But there's no magic behind. It's kind of all about the method, the track screen, and the other one, actually. Then we have the another interface called tracking, which is kind of, in the end, the real implementation of the tracking. And because we don't want to write for each screen some kind of the same code in different classes, we kind of have this interface and the implementation, which then, in the end, kind of depending on which screen you are on, like store details or some other screen, does some different stuff, right? And that's usually the places where stuff can really break, because there's like five if else, and that's already kind of not the best idea to write code, but it's just there, and we want to make sure that this is working correctly. So these two, so in the screen details, we want to make sure that the screen orientation is kind of set as a custom dimension, and we really send out the screen tracking. That's all we want to test. The other one is kind of just a boilerplate around it. So how we would do that in RoboElectric is, so you have this test, and all you want to kind of test is this stateful tracking class. So you create an instance, and everything you kind of, so the persistence settings, for example, we don't need that for the test at all. You just mock it with Mockito, and same for the sync, which is kind of then this Google Analytics implementation. We don't really want to send any Google Analytics data to anyone. We just want to make sure it's kind of here the methods are called correctly. So we mock our kind of scenario. We tell that in this scenario, we want to kind of simulate the state landscape. You could write any string. And then we just call in the track screen method of our kind of stateful tracking. And then we use again Mockito, and it has nice functionalities called verify, where you can make sure that when you call track screen, the mocked sync from here, which you injected here, is calling track screen and is calling set custom dimension to whatever you kind of set up here. And that's already it. With this kind of few lines of code, you can ensure that whenever you call kind of anything in the stateful tracking about the store details, the Google Analytics tracking is really kind of happening. Yeah, all tests passed. Great. Now, if you, for example, would kind of remove that one line of code where you set the screen orientation, or someone messes around with this if-else construct and adds another if there, or kind of changes the value of this store details, you will get this test failed, and it will tell you that the custom dimension number 14, which is the screen orientation here, should be landscape, but Mockito detected that you wanted to invoke the set custom dimension method, but it was actually never called because someone changed the code. And therefore, immediately the test will break and your Google Analytics tracking is safe, and nobody will tell you like months later that you broke something. Because usually those kind of things are not, you don't see them in production, there's no crash involved and nothing kind of really loud. But a few weeks, months later, someone maybe come around and there's some weird data. But with RoboElectric, you can actually do even more than just making sure that this part of code is. So this was a kind of good example of a real unit test. But in Google, with RoboElectric, you can actually test even that the activity, which kind of then performs the tracking, is doing it correctly. So you have this is kind of our activity, and in onCreate, we kind of use the tracking class. We track the screen with the screen orientation, and it detects the screen orientation automatically. And now with RoboElectric, you can actually create the instance of your activity. And if you have kind of, so we have also the replace method in our core components. So we are now replacing the dependency here. So in the production system, we would use the real instance of tracking. But here we kind of use our custom one. And therefore, we can actually even make sure that track screen of stateful tracking of sync, which is kind of mocked and injected into stateful tracking, is called correctly. And yeah, that gives you the possibility to make sure that nobody can even break code in onCreate, because that's also a place people start to mess around and change code. But you want to make sure that this activity is always tracking the right code, right? So with this create here, you can ensure that this onCreate is called, this is called, and with verify, you can verify that all the tracking is correctly done. It's a complicated topic. So testing was never easy. That's why a lot of people kind of have a little bit issues with that. And don't make it even more complicated with kind of definitions and what is a unit test and what is maybe not a unit test anymore. Just kind of try around the tools you want to use for it. And as I mentioned, RoboElectric is a great starting point. And if you understand the concept of dependency injection, how to mock things and replace these components, I think that's kind of step in the right direction. As mentioned, these three things are kind of must have for testing. Now let's step to the next topic, which is UI testing with Espresso. And we used it, so we use Espresso a bit because we like the concept and it's super easy to use. And to explain it a little bit to you, it's kind of this the syntax. If you have never seen it, it's actually plain readable for nearly every developer. Doesn't matter if you are kind of a iOS or whatever developer. So you have those methods. These are coming from this Espresso. So you have onView with ID. You find that ID and you can perform like type text. That one line of code would, or two lines of code, would find a name field and write text there. The second line of code would kind of find the green button and click on it. And the third one would kind of make sure that Hello Steve is displayed in some other view. That code looks already quite easy, and it's really easy and fast forward to write code in this direction. But Espresso has some issues when it's about networking. So it sometimes works very well if you kind of use loaders or kind of different kind of system concepts from Android. But if you use, I don't know, long-running background operations with Volley, that doesn't work correctly. You can actually use, what was the name of this, idling resources, where you can tell your kind of components that they are now doing something, and kind of this whole concept of this idling resources in Espresso will make sure everything is synced correctly, but it somehow never worked 100% correctly. So it always was like 99% fine, but this 1% of failing test randomly was kind of super annoying. So we built kind of a little bit of additional work there. So what we do actually is not hidden magic. We just loop through the 100 times through a loop, wait 200 milliseconds, and immediately try to click on whatever element. So we have like different kind of methods, all of them. So we kind of just immediately try to click on that. If the view is not there, you get this nice exception. We catch it, we ignore it, we sleep 200 milliseconds and retry again. That usually gives you the possibility to you lose maybe 200 milliseconds, but in most of the cases, you're kind of saving yourself from a red test, which was actually just failing because the view was not there. And in the end, it takes you 10 minutes to realize, okay, that was a false positive, you just restart. And that makes our tests kind of really very reliable, so they are not failing because any view is not there. And if 20 seconds later, so the whole stuff would wait 20 seconds, the view is still not there, it will kind of just throw a custom random exception from us, and we know if this happens, really something went bad. So those false positives are kind of gone. So you would kind of change your write, your kind of how you write code into a little bit into this. So from onView with ID search, that's our kind of search icon, into new view target tab. That's kind of a small change, but I still didn't like the syntax too much, and it was kind of still a little bit too much code written there. So we just copied a concept from, I think it's, I'm not sure if Selenium testing kind of invented that concept or it was there before. It's called page objects. It's, I think, a design pattern or just the name for the concept, I don't know. And you kind of just wrap all the functionalities in your page or activity in your view, you give it the name, into kind of very readable methods. And you actually just put that into those easy readable methods, right? And a test which opens the drawer, selects favorites from menus, verifies that the title is correct, and verifies that the user is logged out, because you prepared the test to be like this. It's kind of really just four lines of code, and it's readable for everyone. Even my wife could read that code. So, and it's actually even writable by everyone, because you just use these objects. You know, that's the home page. Yeah, I'm on the home page. I want to open the drawer, and I just use the method. And this page object pattern really kind of gives you the flexibility to make very readable code in testing, and also very maintainable code, which is kind of the next topic I want to talk about this, because usually layout will change in your application, and it will usually change very often, and that's why UI tests are a little bit kind of, okay, you write them, 2 months later the designer decides to change everything, suddenly Google comes up with a new design language, and you have all these kind of problems. So for example, this was our old application, or old version, and this is the new one. We don't have the search icon here on this view anymore. It's now an edit text, you can immediately press on it. And now you have like 20 tests, and all of them are kind of the old way on view with ID. And now you need to change this kind of on view with ID to another ID and 20 tests. You don't want to do that. And with page objects, you kind of have this one method which accesses this location icon. You maybe refactor, rename the method name into kind of perform search or something more meaningful, but you only have to change it in one place. And I think that's the kind of biggest benefit about page object itself. That kind of from readability, you change code from on view with ID, blah, 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 into kind of that's additional step we do, but into home page press location icon. And I think that's everyone can understand and write code like this. And the second kind of idea is maintainability. So usually your core functionality, there will be always some search functionality on that view, but it will be a button, it may be a fab on the bottom, or it will be kind of some other edit text. But you don't want to kind of every time that changes, change 20 tests, you only want to change it in one place. Now back a little bit to tracking and UI. So that's kind of a little bit longer test we kind of have written. I think I've written it just for this example. There's no real code like this. But so this test actually, I mean, let's go to the screens. So it kind of opens the menu, it logs you in, it verifies it's logged out, it has no messages, and it logs out again. So that's kind of the test scenario we want to verify. And we don't really want to verify that the UI is actually working correctly, but underlying behind that, there's some tracking going on. So therefore, we want to ensure that the tracking on, behind this is going correctly. So we kind of implement a new tracking sync. So we had this one for Google Analytics in production, and we now have a memory tracking sync where we kind of every time track screen is called, just save this event in memory, like we have an array list, and this array list, all the events are kind of just added, and you kind of in the end can verify that the order of this tracking is correctly. This is just a kind of interface to make sure you are able to use kind of testable screen and testable event and whatever Google Analytics offers you. And in the end, you again just replace your real implementation of your tracking sync. You just say, okay, I don't need this Google Analytics stuff or whatever is connected there. I just use kind of this memory tracking sync. And when you run your application in kind of this test scenario, you will recognize that kind of there's no data sent to anyone. It just keeps everything in this kind of memory. And you can even put the breakpoint at the end of the test, look into that memory and see, okay, in this case, there was like a screen home category L10 L1 overview. That's the name of our screen. There's another screen. There's an event, and screen. And you can actually, during kind of running this test, verify that your tracking is not only correctly, but that also gives you a kind of possibilities to look, okay, what is my current state of the application? So you write the UI test, you look what's your current state, you discuss with everyone, is this kind of the state we want to agree on, and based on that, you could, for example, then write a test like this, where you say, okay, in this scenario, I know that there are five events sent out. The first one is actually a screen, and it has this name, and you can continue to write whatever you want to verify there. And it gives you the possibility to kind of ensure that in this scenario, your test is changing. Of course, if you now add new tracking or change tracking somewhere, this might change. So better make sure that kind of you don't write millions of tests, because that different that heavily be depends on how much you change this kind of concepts. Yeah, so that brings me to the next topic. Don't overuse UI tests or Espresso. I mean, it's really easy to use, and lots of people understand that much more than actually writing unit tests. And usually people start to write a lot of UI tests, but they are actually really slow, and they kind of have a very long execution time. which at the end point will be a little bit the problem that when you push your code, you usually want to get feedback immediately, but when the CI server suddenly starts to be busy for like 10 minutes, 15 minutes, because it needs to run the whole suite or even longer, that's kind of no fun anymore. So try to keep that at the minimum and kind of maximize the amount of unit tests you can actually write, or this kind of a little bit more than a unit test which RoboElectric offers you. Make sure they are easy to read and maintain, because I mean, how often does your HTTP stack or cache or stuff you unit test, you have written tests there, and they are there forever, and then you don't want to replace that every, I don't know, 2 years, 3 years, maybe there's like a new security issue in HTTPS, whatever, and you need to change the implementation there, you need to change tests there, but your layout will change really often, so it's like every month or every 2 months their designer wants to have a new shiny icon and different kind of things will change there. So you need to maintain those tests, and if you have a bunch of UI tests, you will end up in the hell of maintaining those tests too much. And I can also give you the hint to consider to have like two or more different types of test plans. One which kind of makes sure that the kind of functionality or the core functionality of your application works. Stuff that doesn't, that cannot break, needs to be tested. But there are kind of things which are like long-running edge cases. So we have like, if you are a very new user, you have never done this, and you go to that screen, you have to verify that this is working. And this is something we as a developer don't really test that often, because that's kind of, you have your username, you are logged in your application while debugging and testing, but you kind of need to create a new user now just for this one test case, and you are already like, oh, creating a new user will take me 2 minutes. So having like a second test suite which runs overnight and kind of verifies those edge cases which barely breaks because they are kind of somewhere hidden in the functionality, kind of are also executed, or just have kind of a suite which is only kind of for releases. So you know, okay, we are doing a release, run this 2 hours kind of UI test suite. That's a possibility to kind of make sure you don't wait when you push too long time. Yeah, that's basically it. I hope you enjoyed it a little bit. I hope you learned something. And are there any questions? There's one. Which? In the UI test, you mean? So the loop. The loop has actually. So we don't mock all. So as I mentioned, so we have kind of. We have tests, like layout tests, let's call it layout tests, where we mock the networking completely away. We load stuff from JSON, we display the JSON, and we know, okay, the title is this text because we know it. But we have also kind of a little bit more integration tests. So for example, one test is kind of making sure sending messages to users works, which you cannot really mock because kind of we want to test a little bit more than just our kind of isolated state. So there's a test which logs in with a very new user, goes to the very first ad on a test server we have. It's not a live production server. We don't send messages to real people. Kind of then sends a message to the specific user, goes to the messages overview, and kind of waits till it verifies that the message is there. The problem here is that the live server does that in 100 milliseconds. It's immediately there because we have like really hard hardware standing around for this messaging system. On our test server, there's like, I think, a very small virtual machine somewhere. It doesn't really work. It takes like 5 seconds. So the UI test is actually way faster than our kind of test server setup, but we still want to ensure the scenario works well. So we just kind of implemented that, and now we have to wait kind of. And this will make sure that even though it takes 200 milliseconds or 5 seconds, this test will not fail. Yeah. So this is not about mocking away the network connectivity or stuff. This is really because Espresso is so fast that even if you mock the data away, it may be even faster than your callback. So usually you have like still a thread in the background and you kind of click on that button and 100 milliseconds later you get a callback. But sometimes Espresso is even faster than those 100 milliseconds and it would still fail. So this kind of made in the end sure from that 99.something% of the tests which kind of passed, we ended up in a really like networking was no issue anymore. Or long running operations, it doesn't need to be networking. Yes?
Sorry. So my question is, where do you run the UI tests? Do you use real devices, emulators, in-house?
We actually use only one Genymotion instance on our CI server and one specific we agreed on API version we decided to be the most stable one. So we don't test on 10 devices because I think that those days where kind of you had really big issues on different devices, they are kind of gone with the newer devices, let's say like this. So all kind of manufacturers kind of had some good new hardware now out, and for most of our users that works quite well. So there will be always this cheap device from somewhere which will crash, but that's kind of then something we will fix later. Yes.
Which Groovy? Did you try ever Groovy with RoboElectric and Spot Framework?
I mean, Spock, I used it a bit, but not really, like, I didn't spend more than a few hours to kind of just get into it and then never used it. Sorry. Any more questions? Yeah, there are still more questions.
Do you hear me?
No. Yes, try.
About the complex example with tracking.
Yes.
I asked myself whether RoboElectric is there.
Not necessarily, but as I mentioned, so we decided to use RoboElectric in kind of all our unit tests as kind of the run suite, because it doesn't make a real difference if you use plain JUnit or this kind of RoboElectric. It might be a 10 milliseconds difference for this one test. If you scale that up, at some point you might need to think about it, but in our case it's just easier to just write everything in RoboElectric.
Well, you said that you're using a service locator instead of Dagger, but the code you have shown assumes that it's working with reflection. And this is quite slow, especially on mobile devices. Why are you doing this?
We didn't realize any slowness in this, I must admit. So, no. I mean, we just use it because it works for us. So we kind of replaced it with Dagger for a few components, and there was like no difference. It was even a bit of overhead in kind of objects which were created in the background. So, yeah.
I have also the question, who is writing tests, unit tests in your company? Do you have QAs at all?
The last part again?
Do you have QAs in your company? In the beginning you asked about iOS developers.
Jing is our QA.
Other developers.
So actually everyone kind of should write tests. So we kind of try to make sure that every developer is part of the writing test process, so everyone knows how to do it. It sometimes works better and sometimes works not so well. So of course we kind of try to increase the code coverage with every new feature we are writing, but sometimes it's also kind of, we are a heavily data-driven company, so we usually, create an A-B test with two different layouts or three different layouts, and kind of, if we would kind of write tests for all of this stuff so we are not writing, for example, test-driven development, we don't do it. And if we kind of would go into the direction of test-driven development with A-B testing, which means you are writing like four or five different versions of your layouts, that would be kind of a little bit of an overhead. So we try to find a good mixture, but mainly it's kind of the developers' work. So the developers who write the feature write also the tests. We have one QA engineer, which kind of is involved a lot into kind of setting up everything like this and making kind of this framework working correctly, ensuring this kind of last few percent are kind of working quite well, but he is not the guy who's sitting there and writing tests for us. No, we have no QA department testing our application.
Is this Expresso for UI tests is a tool something like Appium, or what is the difference?
So I'm not 100% into Appium. I used it a bit. So Espresso is really just kind of for Android. You can't use it for anything else, as long as I know. So I think in Appium you kind of can write tests which then are executed also on iOS, so it gives a little bit different functionalities. Yes, but I think it's kind of a similar concept. Yeah. It's by Google. It's I think it's open source. Yeah, it's open source. More questions? Yeah, here's one more. Can you pass the mic here? Ah, there's okay. Just.
So how do you test on Android Marshmallow? For example, they have those security notification, security alerts, system alerts. How do you deal with that? Or for example, if you test on Jelly Motion, then I think it's not possible to do Jelly Motion. Please
point out. We kind of mocked that away, so we avoid that problem by mocking the state of the user accepted the permission. So it's kind of before the tests start, we kind of set the Boolean value to ensure that kind of the user already accepted the permission, and then we don't ask the permission. So that works. What? We didn't test them automated. So we. The question was how we kind of deal with this new permission dialogues on Android, which pops up on Android Marshmallow from Marshmallow. In our UI test, for example, and we just don't. So we don't have test scenarios for that cases. We just go the positive way in this direction. But yeah, valid argument. Yeah.
So, hello. So how long have you been using Espresso? With how many tests do you have? And what were the biggest problems that you ran into with it?
That is one. Yeah. So being annoyed by a test which fails, and actually it shouldn't, because you know it's true. It just there was some state where I don't know, the emulator was kind of waiting too long, or the network response took too long. That was a super annoying one. I'm using Espresso, I think, now for more than 2 years in general. And I think we have like 50, 60 tests in our kind of, which are executed every time you push our code, which is kind of not covering all cases for sure. But it kind of really makes sure that the core functionality stuff works quite well, and kind of all those kind of happy passes are working well. That's kind of the. Okay, then we will kind of switch to the next talk, which is iOS.